Hey, all across this room, would you pray with me? Father, this morning, this is our testimony, that you are faithful and true. Father, that you are a good God, and we love you this morning. Jesus, thank you for loving us so much. Your word tells us where two or three are gathered in your name, that your presence is with us. And so we thank you, Father, for meeting with us this morning. Lord, we ask that you'd speak to our hearts and speak to our minds as we yield our lives to you. Have your way this morning. We just love you so much. In Jesus' mighty name. And everybody said, amen, amen. Guys, y'all sounded awesome this morning. Hey, as you're seated, tell somebody around you, I'm glad you're here this morning. Well, hey, this morning, we are going to be continuing in our series entitled Times and Seasons. And if you have a Bible, I want you to grab it real quick. And I want you to open up in the New Testament to Matthew chapter 26. Matthew chapter 26. And we're going to continue in this that we started 3 weeks ago or 2 weeks ago. The first week, just as kind of a recapturing, make sure we're on track. We talked about understanding our season. The truth of the matter is that in our lives and as we follow the Lord, we go through seasons. Not everything is just linear. Not everything is just always straight and steady. But we go through seasons in our lives. And we talked in this first week about in understanding our season, we talked about time. And we talked about two dynamics. We'll put an image on the screen. We talked about Chronos and Kairos time. Chronos time, hopefully we can find that. Chronos time is a linear time. It is measured in seconds. It's measured in minutes. It's measured in hours and days. It's this idea that I'm going from one point to the next point. But inside of Chronos time, there's also the circular time of Kairos time, that we have moments. For instance, in our life, we'll often say, I had the time of my life. Or I had a great time. College was the best time. We're talking about moments. And one of the challenges for a lot of us is we struggle with our walk with God because we get really confused on Chronos. We get really confused on linear time. God's not moving fast enough. Why are the doors not opening for me? Why aren't things working out? I've been praying for healing. Healing hasn't come. I've been praying for somebody to return to the Lord. They haven't returned. I've been praying for this relationship to restore. It hasn't restored. We get frustrated with Chronos, and we tend to miss Kairos. And we've been talking in the context of this series of pulling back, understanding that in any season that you're in, God offers you these Kairos moments. The time, the moment to be able to be with him, to worship him, to be changed by him, to have God do something in your life in that season, whether it's working out how you would like or not. So that's what we talked about in that first week. Last week, we looked at another image and we talked about this concept of stages of being given, blessed, broken, and sent out. We used the story in the Bible where Jesus is feeding 5,000 and he takes the bread, he blesses the bread, he breaks the bread, and then he distributes the bread. And we talked about that there was a window for understanding some seasons in our lives, that there's a time that maybe you're giving your life to the Lord. It's a season of where you're just yielding to him. You don't necessarily have everything you want, but it's, Lord, whatever you want with my life, whatever you want in this relationship, whatever you want to do, I'm open for. Then you follow that with a season of blessing where it seems like things are working and things are pouring out and doors are opening, and it's a season of blessing. But there's always, for all of us, there's a season of brokenness too, where God takes that which he was blessing and he begins to break it. And it's not an easy season. It's not a confident season. It's a time where God is taking that which he blessed and he breaks it. He multiplies it. And ultimately to send it out. But it's that breaking period that's very, very tough. And we talked about just in this spectrum, you can't really tell when it goes from giving to blessing. They kind of merge. And you can't really tell when blessing and breaking, you know, separate, because they kind of merge. And breaking and sending out, it looks like they kind of blend together. But yet understanding, pulling the lens back and saying, okay, this is the time and this is the season that God has me in for right now. Very powerful tool if we can apply it in our life. What I want to do today is I want to talk about something pertaining to one of these seasons, and it's the broken season. Today we're going to talk about when you're in that broken season, or you're headed to that broken season, you're coming out of that broken season, or specifically if you have a loved one who's in it. We're going to be using the term this morning, night seasons, because sometimes when you're in a night season, it's difficult. For instance, you're in your home and you're walking around during the day and there's some creaks in your house. You don't think anything of it. You think, I got to replace that air conditioner, or I got to replace or fix that stairwell. It doesn't bother you during the day, but if you hear those creaks at night, you're like, the boogeyman is in my home, you know? Or you're walking around through your home during the day, and you're not looking at windows to see if somebody's peering in. You don't think there's a set of eyes. But at night, you walk to the kitchen, and you're like, somebody's looking in my window, you know? The night season makes us a little more fearful. We're a little more skittish in the night season. Sometimes we go through night seasons. And what I would hope today is that today's talk will be more helpful than it will be heavy. It could be heavy because some of us are in a night season. Or maybe you've just come out of a night season and you're looking back and you're like, that was really tough. I really did not know how I was going to get through that. Or you might have a loved one. You might have adult children and you're watching your adult children go through a night season. And it's tough as a parent when you're watching them and you'd love to rescue them, but you can't. And you've got grandkids involved and you're watching them in a night season. Or maybe it's a sibling. You have a brother or a sister who's going through a financial night season or going through a medical night season, and you're watching it and you'd love to come to their rescue, but you just can't. And so today what I would hope is that this talk is going to be more helpful. If you are in a night season, what are some things you can do or think as you go through it? If you're coming out of it, if you're on one of the bookends, you're headed into it or you're coming out of it, what are some things that you can think about? What are some things you can do? And also, maybe you have a coworker that you're watching. Maybe you have a neighbor that you're watching, a friend that you're watching. And sometimes you don't know what to say. Sometimes when they're in a night season, you're like, I don't exactly know what I can or can't say to them. I pray that today might give you something to think about and some tools maybe even to talk with them about. So yesterday I was at the baseball fields. Typically I'm at the baseball fields almost every day. But I was at the baseball fields because we were having our last day of the season, last Saturday game of the season. And I was walking around and it was interesting that at the field, it was real somber. There weren't a lot of people. A lot of teams have already checked out. A lot of parents have gone home. A lot of kids aren't coming back to the fields. It was kind of somber. And I thought yesterday, it's very interesting from the first day of the season compared to the last day of the season. Because the first day of the season, when you walk onto the fields and you walk into that area, I mean, it is buzzing with anticipation. It's buzzing with optimism. Everybody's cheering. Everybody's excited. Everybody's got lots of expectation. And part of that is because there's optimism about what's going to happen. They're thinking little Tommy's going to have the season of his life. I mean, he's going to throw a no-hitter. I bought him that new bat. He's finally going to be able to hit. And Tommy's confidence is going to skyrocket. Or little Susie's going to finally get the chance to play. She's been bench warmer for seasons. This is her season. Little Susie is going to finally enjoy this game. Here's the challenge. On that first day, you have no idea how it's going to go. You can't plan for an injury to little Tommy. You can't plan for the frustrations that might come to little Susie. You don't know whether she's going to play or not. You don't know when you start something how exactly it's going to finish. And I was thinking about that yesterday in context to what we're talking about. Truth be told, for all of us, you don't know how your seasons are going to end. Like, our seasons are started with great optimism, but we really don't know how it's all going to end per se. You're at an interview, and you reach across the desk, and you shake hands. Thank you, I'd love to take the job. But you really don't know how that's going to play out. You sit down with a realtor and you sign papers on the house because you imagine that it's all going to go really well, but you really don't know. You post on Facebook these really fantastic, cute, and clever, creative ways of telling everybody, we're pregnant, we're having a baby. But you really don't know how it's going to go. You spend thousands of dollars on a wedding, but you really don't know how it's going to go. And there's a lot of mileage. There's a lot of time in between a wedding cake and a silver cake. There's a lot of time and a lot of mileage in between accepting a job and retiring from that job. And sometimes for some people, maybe even in here, the child was born with a disability. Or maybe the house that you signed with so much anticipation and excitement actually had to be foreclosed on. Or the wedding that you were like, forever, till death do us part, for better or for worse. You really didn't anticipate pushing them in a wheelchair for so long. A person who is married and ends up being widowed 25 years or so before they ever anticipated that. We all are surrounded at times with night seasons, and sometimes you will endure a night season. This week, on Friday alone, one day for me, and not that every day is like this, but on Friday alone, I sat in a bedroom with a person that attends Bridgeway, is a part of Bridgeway, and has been fighting stage 4 colon cancer for some time, and is near the end, and was sitting beside his bed, hand on chest, talking to him, praying with him, reading scripture, tears coming down his face, has been struggling with lucidity, but for the moment that I was there with him, he was with me, and was very lucid, and we prayed, and we talked, and it's sobering when you're in the home of a family that's in the night season. I came back to the office and I was talking with one of the staff members about it, and then I went about my day and they went about their day. Later that day, they got a phone call of devastating news that has changed their scenario as well. And instantly, unexpectedly, we're individually put into a night season. Got an email about a couple hours later from another church member that had something happen unexpectedly, and they're in a financial night season that they have no idea how they're going to come out of. Night seasons, they can come on us, and they can be very unexpected. And how do you deal with that? If I were to give a visual of what that's like, I think of the visual of a bridge. For instance, I'll put an image of a bridge here. This is a bridge up in Washington State, and a bridge spans a course. It spans two obstacles, so to say, where you can travel across, and they're strong, and nobody gets to travel the bridge until it's established. But this exact bridge last year endured too much pressure, too much weight, and this became that bridge. You think about another famous bridge in Minneapolis in 2007 ended up collapsing, and literally the whole city of Minneapolis was affected, and many people lost their lives from this bridge collapse. This week I read of a story of a bridge in Pennsylvania that happened this last month. This is the image of it. This bridge that you're looking at is a bridge that's a little over 100 years old. It's a wooden bridge. Little over 100 years old. It's got a 4-ton capacity. This driver decided to drive his 35-ton truck across the 4-ton bridge, and that bridge gave way, and it now has to be destroyed. A bridge that was once strong, but listen, just too much pressure. Too many cars coming across. Too many things. Sometimes you and I can be like a bridge. We're strong, we're able, but sometimes you can have just too much come across you. You can have just too many of those fights, too many bad news calls, too much pressure, and you can feel like that bridge that's going to collapse. When you turn to Matthew chapter 26, we're going to be looking at the story that's commonly called the Garden of Gethsemane. Jesus, the Son of God, was in a time that his bridge, so to say, using the visual, was close to collapsing. Too much pressure, too many things, just too much happening at once. The Garden of Gethsemane geography is still there today. Geographically is still there today. Put an image of it. This is the Garden of Gethsemane today. The Garden of Gethsemane, just outside of Jerusalem, is part of what is called the Mount of Olives. It's a region of olive trees. And because of that, this term Gethsemane means olive pressing or crushing place. Pressing of oils is what it often would be called. This place that they would take olives and literally crush the olives to get the oil to have olive oil. Very simple. This Gethsemane. Now, here's what's interesting. When I say the Garden of Gethsemane, Gethsemane is not historically famous because of the olives or because of its name. It's not historically famous because of an item that's inside this garden, like Old Faithful or a waterfall or any of that. Gethsemane is famous because of something that happened there. And not just happened on one occasion, it happened on one night inside of really 1 hour. One event happens that makes this place famous. For instance, let me say this. If I were to say the term grassy knoll, there are millions of little hills covered in grass over the course of our country. Why, when I use the term grassy knoll, do the majority, if not all of you, visualize one particular hill in downtown Dallas? It's because an event happened at that little hill that changed history. Gethsemane is like that. Gethsemane is the location that Jesus is at in the final night of his life. He is just moments from being betrayed, arrested, beaten, and ultimately crucified. And he is in a night season. And so in Matthew chapter 26, it tells us this, looking at verse 36. It says this, "Then Jesus went with his disciples to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to them, 'Sit here while I go over there and pray.' He took Peter and the two sons of Zebedee along with him, and he began to be sorrowful and troubled. Then he said to them, 'My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. Stay here and keep watch with me.' Going a little further, he fell with his face to the ground and prayed, 'My Father, if it's possible, may this cup be taken from me, yet not as I will, but as you will.' Then he returned to his disciples and found them sleeping. 'Could you men not keep watch with me for 1 hour?' Then he asked Peter, 'Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the body is weak.' He went away a second time and prayed, 'My Father, if it's not possible for this cup to be taken away unless I drink it, may your will be done.' When he came back, he again found them sleeping because their eyes were heavy. So he left them and went away once more and prayed the third time, saying the same thing. Then he returned to the disciples and said to them, 'Are you still sleeping and resting? Look, the hour is near, and the Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us go. Here comes my betrayer.'" Now, if you're going through it, if you're coming out of it, if you're headed into it, or you know somebody that is already in it, what I want to talk to you about is five things from this story that might help you, might be sources of encouragement for you to talk with them about. And so let's jump right in and kind of unpack these. The first is this: don't be ashamed that you're in a night season. Don't be ashamed that you're in a night season. I find over the years in talking with people, sometimes we are very embarrassed, hidden about the fact that we're going through a night season. This is something that we all go through from time to time. A couple of verses on this. Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 1 says, "There is a time for everything and a season for every activity under heaven." Two verses that parallel from the Garden of Gethsemane, Matthew chapter 26, verse 45 says, "Then he returned to the disciples and said to them, 'Are you still sleeping and resting? "Look, the hour is near, and the Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners." John chapter 12, verse 23 says, Jesus replied, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified." Listen, night seasons are true for us all. They're true of people in the Bible. You look at Abraham. Abraham went through his of not knowing which way was up, which way was true north. Moses goes through it. Joseph goes through it. David goes through it. People all throughout the Bible go through this metaphorical night season. You and I are going to have those experiences where we go through it as well. And sometimes as a man, you can go through a night season and you can be embarrassed. You don't want to tell your wife. You don't want to tell other guys. You want to be Superman. You want to be a superhero. You want to have a cape flying. I never go through tough times. Sometimes as a mom, you want to go through and you want everybody to know you're strong. You want your kids to know you're strong. You want your spouse to know you're strong. You want all the other mothers. You go to a mom's group and you don't want to tell those moms that you're struggling because they're all bragging on how great everything is. Their kids are making straight A's. They had time to make turkey pot pie. They clean their whole house by 9 a.m. They're all bragging on what they did and you're thinking, I'm barely making it. And you don't want to tell the truth. You don't want to say, I'm at my wit's end. You know, you and I have people that we talk to where we give different levels of honesty, right? To some degree of people you walk to and they ask, how are you doing? You say, I'm doing great. I'm doing fantastic, even though you're not. And then there's another group of people that when you see them, they ask, hey, how are you doing? You say, I'm doing okay. I'm struggling, but I'm going to make it. And then there's another group of people, this is a smaller group of people that you can really be honest with. And when they ask, how are you doing? You're like, I'm all kinds of jacked up. I am losing my mind. I'm losing my mind on my kids. I'm losing my mind on my spouse. I am losing it, you know, right? We have those degrees of people. And I'm not saying that you're that kind of jacked up honest with everybody. I'm just saying that you've got to put that cape away that you're a superhero thinking that God is never going to allow you to go through a night season. You and I are going to go through them from time to time. You and I are going to suffer the difficulty of saying goodbye to somebody that we did not expect to have to say goodbye to. You and I are going to have at some point or another that in our stomach when you get the news from a doctor that you did not anticipate getting. You ever go to a dentist and you thought that that dentist was going to tell you, it all looks perfect. Can we use your teeth as an image in a magazine? And they say, you know, well, you have three cavities and that tooth has to be pulled and you've got an impacted molar. And you're like, what? I thought it was good. I've been flossing and brushing. Listen, we all go through it. There are going to be times that you get news you didn't want to hear. There's going to be times that the prayers that you've been praying don't get answered. And that's not a statement against God. And that's not anything that you should at any point be ashamed by. And let me push into this. In not being ashamed of going through a night season, listen to me on this. You have to be okay with the fact that other people might not be going through the night season with you. You might be traveling in your night season and they just simply are not coming along with you. And you can't get angry and violent towards people like, you just don't understand. You don't love. You don't care. You can't go there. Jesus is going through a night season. He's at a point and place, Father, if it's possible, take this cup from me. Goes back to the disciples, and they are asleep. Those jokers are sleeping on him. He wakes them up, gives them some kind of encouragement. Wake up, Peter. Spirit is willing, flesh is weak. I've said for years, I'm convinced he's talking about himself, not them. And he says, wake up. Let me give you some information. My soul is overwhelmed to the point of death, is what Scripture says. He goes back to pray. He's praying, Father, if it's possible, take this cup from me. He goes back, and those jokers are asleep again. Listen to me. Let me be very honest about something. There comes a point where you realize that the people you're reaching out to aren't going to go there with you. There comes a point that you come to realize, I'm going through this alone. And you can be married and going through a night season alone. You can be a parent and your kids have no idea that you're in a night season in your soul. You can be married and sleep next to somebody and they have no idea that your soul is in a night season. It's possible to go through that. Because there are times that you realize, I'm the only one. For instance, let me say this. Men, have you ever heard men say, you know, we're having a baby? Sure you have. You're not having a baby. She's having a baby, you know? You go to the hospital, and she's in labor and screaming and all that, sweating, just eating ice chips and everything. He's got a cheeseburger, honey. It's coming in 2 minutes. She knows. She can feel it's coming in 2 minutes, you know, right? They're both not having a baby. She's having a baby. He's watching her have a baby. There are times, you'll be in a night season and you'll be alone. But God is faithful to you, and he will never leave you alone without his presence with you. Here's what I would push on first stuff. If you are in it, or you're trying to figure out how to talk to somebody who's in it, help yourself or help them understand not to be ashamed of the fact that you're in a night season, because we all walk through them from time to time. And that brings us to number two, is don't be ashamed of your exhaustion. Don't be ashamed of your exhaustion in the night season. A couple of verses here, Mark chapter 14, speaking of this same scenario, it says, he took Peter, James, and John along with him, and he began to be deeply distressed and troubled. He says, my soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. He said to them, stay here and keep watch. Jesus says to him, the spirit is willing, flesh is weak. In Luke 22, verse 44, it says, and being in anguish, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat was like drops of blood falling to the ground. Leave that verse up for just a second. That is such an interesting statement. That's such an interesting verse. Medically, this is a condition called hematidrosis, when a person can be under such anxiety or such anguish or pressure that their sweat, literally the blood, the capillaries start to secrete blood through their sweat glands. It's a very interesting, very rare condition, but you have to be under incredible duress, under incredible tension, and Jesus is in such anguish. Now, this term anguish there came from a Greek word that you're instantly going to know parallel to. It's spelled A-G-O-N-I-A, agoneia. It's where we get the term agony. It comes from this term that was used of wrestlers that would be contending. It was really a word depicting a struggle for victory. He is in such struggle for victory. His soul is overwhelmed to the point of death, and he is entirely, entirely exhausted. Let's be honest. Let's be very real. It's just you and me having a cup of coffee here. No one else is in the room. There have been things you've gone through, and you got through it. And you're like, I got through that, but I don't know if I'm going to get through this, right? I got through that, and God carried me through that situation, but I'm tired right now. I had energy when I was younger. I had lots of, gas in the tank, so to say. But now I find myself to be very weary and tired, and I've been doing this so long, and I don't know if I'm going to get through this, even though I got through that. You cannot be ashamed of the fact that you're exhausted when you're going through a night season. And so you have to be very practical. You have to be very wise in your life. And you can counsel this. How are you going to refill in that time? You have to be strategic in how you're going to rest. Very basic stuff. How you eat. How you sleep. How are you going to recover and recreate in this time period? I was talking with a dear lady in our church recently, not too long ago. She's going through a night season, was going through a tough time. And this was the visual I gave her. I said, right now you are empty. Your tank is empty. And this might apply to somebody here. I said, your tank is absolutely empty. Let's use the visual of a car. You go and you fill your car tank up. I mean, obviously with the car, if it ran out of gas, you wouldn't just leave it on the side of the road. But here's the challenge. You don't have enough money to fill it up. You remember when you were young, and I said to her, you remember when you were young and you only had $5 and you could only get $5 of gas? You remember that day? You know, and you go to the gas station, like, I can't fill it up, but I can get $5 of gas. That gives me another day of driving. And in that day, I've got to figure out where I'm going to get my next $5. And you would drive with $5 of gas. Sometimes when you're in a night season, you have to figure out how you, in your soul, you're going to get $5 of gas. You might not be able to fill up. You might not be able to take the vacation to Hawaii. You might not be able to go to the month-long, you know, marriage seminar, you know, retreat. You have to figure out, how are we going to get $5 of gas in this marriage right now? How are we going to get $5 of gas in my heart right now? How am I going to get $5 of gas in my soul right now? When you're in a night season, you have to start thinking about your rest, your sleep, and how do you recover? It's very important, and you cannot be ashamed that you're exhausted, and you have to start being strategic. What can we do? Let's say in a marriage context, you can't go to the month-long seminar and retreat, but you can figure out, we can go for a 10-minute walk today. It's going to put $5 of gas in our marriage. It's not going to solve all the fights. It's not going to solve the kid issues. It's not going to solve the financial issues, but it's $5 of gas that's going to get us through the next couple of days. You figure out how we are going to start to rest even when we're in a night season. And that brings you to number three. You cannot be ashamed of praying the same thing. This one is really important to me, so all antennas up. You cannot be ashamed of praying the same thing when you're in a night season. One of the things that I have watched in my life, this has been a great source of encouragement, what we're going to talk about here. And it's been something that comes up in numerous conversations with people who are in night seasons, is you find yourself praying the same thing because you don't know what to pray or how to pray. When you're in a night season, or your loved one is, they come in prayer, Lord, would you fix it? If you're not going to fix it, would you fix me? That's all I got, Lord. And walk away. Next day, come back. Lord, it's me again. I don't have any new prayers. Would you fix it? Or would you fix me? That's all I got. Walk away. And the next day, you come back. Lord, it's me again. When you're watching somebody who has a disease, Lord, fix it or fix me. When you're watching finances go nowhere but in the wrong direction, Lord, please fix it or fix me. When you're watching the relationship still struggle even though you're trying, Lord, please fix it or fix me. And you find yourself praying the same thing over and over and over. Years ago, this Garden of Gethsemane story helped me so much with the situation I was going through. I was very frustrated, and I started to wrestle with what I think a lot of people wrestle with, a feeling like I was doubting God because I kept saying the same thing. And I thought if I had faith, I would only need to pray it once. If I had faith, I would pray it once and believe it and stand on it, but I found myself continuing to return to a God fix it or fix me scenario. And then one day, this leaped out at me, where it says here in Matthew chapter 26, verse 44, so he left them and went away once more and prayed the third time, saying the same thing. On three occasions, Jesus comes to this place away from his disciples and he says, Father, if it's possible, let this cup pass. If it's possible. If we can come up with any scenario. He does it three times. And in years ago, in this struggle of mine, I had an aha moment that we are talking about Jesus, the Son of God. There is no one with greater faith. There is no one who has seen God, been God, is God, and yet he in his humanity is praying the same thing. And for me, I thought, I am never going to eclipse him in faith. I am never going to eclipse him in knowing God. I am never going to eclipse him in really anything except the negative side of things. And yet he prayed the same thing. And for me, years ago, in this one moment, it stood out that him praying the same thing was not a statement of doubt, but it was a statement of faith. Because there comes a point where you are wrestling with something and you have no one else to go to but him. It is a statement of faith when I take my night season, whatever it might be, and I continue to go back to the Father, recognizing no one can do anything with this but you. The fact that I keep returning to you is my statement of faith. And somebody in here, you got to understand that even though you've been praying over and 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 over for this healing, for this restoration, it's not a statement of doubt. Keep praying in your night season. Keep praying in your night season. Keep returning to the Father. Keep saying that thing. Keep praying that thing. It's not a statement of doubt. It is a statement of faith that God, you are the only one that can do anything about it. And you are my source of strength in this. And in that, it comes to number four. When you're in that night season, you're saying, I'm praying the same thing over and over and over. I can't allow my will or your will to overtake his will. Don't allow your will to overtake God's will. In my notes beside it, I wrote the word hijack. Don't let your will hijack God's will. Don't let it happen. Don't let it happen. I'll give you a couple of verses here and then I'll push on something. Matthew chapter 26, verse 39 says, going a little further, he fell with his face to the ground and prayed, my Father, if it's possible, may this cup be taken from me, yet not as I will, but as you will. That term fell, That term fell there was a term that had a visual to it. It was a visual word, not just a statement word, it was a visual word. It was often used of a lady in labor. She, just imagine a lady in labor. You've watched a lady in labor. You maybe have been in labor. And like, you know, I mean, there's no casual pregnant lady like walking like this, you know. She is all kinds of jacked up herself, right, you know. And she's walking funny and everything. Jesus is carrying this burden to the point. And he's down. And he's praying, Father, if it's possible, let this cup pass. But not my will, your will be done. And then watch this. This is important. Luke 22, verse 43 says, an angel from heaven appeared to him and strengthened him. An angel from heaven appeared to him and strengthened him. Now, let me push on something. I'm going to put a visual up here of two strengths. And this is available to every one of us when you're in a night season. You can have yielded strength or you can have anxious strength. Yielded strength is what Jesus is doing. It is very difficult. But God gives you his spirit. And God will assign an angel or angels to strengthen you. The Bible says that an angel strengthened him. That God will give you what you need. That $5 a guess. He will strengthen you in the difficulty of it. But it comes from this place of saying, Father, nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done. I don't want to rush out of this garden and force my will. I do not want to hijack your will for my life. I do not want to hijack your will over my family. And this is so difficult to stay here. This is so difficult to keep praying the same thing. This is a really dark night season for me. But nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done. The anxious strength is a lot easier. It's a lot easier to lean into anxious strength. In yielded strength, you don't try and manipulate God's will. In anxious strength, I'm so anxious about this, you will attempt to manipulate it. By your own force, you find yourself edgier. You find yourself forcing things. You find yourself fighting teachers when you have no business fighting teachers. You find yourself fighting your boss when you know you shouldn't be fighting your boss. You find yourself fighting your spouse when you're like, why are we fighting? I'm so quick to fight. I'm so quick to fight my parents. I'm so quick to fight somebody. Why is that? I'm leaning into anxious strength because I really need this thing to change. And I'm going to attempt to alter it. I'm going to try and get myself out of this season quicker than I should. You and I can lean into one of these two. I've said for years, listen to me, I've said for years that pain has a voice. It does, it does, it does. Pain has a voice in every person's life. And pain, one of the real challenges for us is to govern pain in a way that pain does not speak loud enough to make me start drawing into anxious strength. I'm going to manipulate this marriage. I'm going to manipulate this job. I'm going to manipulate this situation because I got to get out of it. Yielded strength. Do not let your will hijack or overtake God's will, where you pull back and say, God, nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done. And listen to me. even though you have a promise that God will bring you out, remember our graph, given, blessed, broken, sent out. Even though you have the promise of being sent out, you still have to go through the process. And it's so difficult when both your will and God's will are trying to line up. Imagine a clock. You've got two arms moving in the same direction, but they're moving at a different pace. And then that one moment that they line up, it's where your will is moving faster and God's will is moving slower, but that one moment that they line up, you say, nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done. You cannot be ashamed that you're in a night season. You cannot be ashamed that you're exhausted in a night season. You cannot be ashamed that you're praying the same thing in that season. And this fourth one, you cannot allow your will to overtake or hijack his will in your life. And that brings me to this fifth one. And this is a tough one. This last one is this. When your night season is concluding, rise and walk out. Let me push in something here. This one's a tough one. When your night season concludes, don't leave early. Don't leave early. But when it's concluding, you got to rise and walk out of it. There's a point that Jesus says to his disciples, look, my accusers are here. Rise and let us go. And he leaves the garden. Listen to me. I'm going to step into really tough waters here. There's an appropriate time of grieving a loss. There's an appropriate time of getting counsel through the night season that somebody put you in. And I'm not suggesting in any way that it's a week, a month, a year. I'm not suggesting anything to a timeline for how long you need. But there is a point, listen to me, tough waters here. There is a point that you have to walk out of that garden. I've watched over the years people that were abused verbally, physically, sexually, were abused, and they forever stayed in their garden. Somebody who lost mom or dad or a loved one early on, years ago, truth be told, they're still in the garden. Going through a health scare, going through a financial scare, going through a relational collapse, going through unforgiveness, going through pain, they're still in the garden. And I don't know what the appropriate grieving time is for you, but there comes a point that I do believe that the Spirit of the Lord would say, it's time to rise up and walk out of it. If you were to think about a lady who is pregnant, we know the time and the season is a 9-month season. And so at about 7 months, you know it is too early. It's too early for her to have the baby. Even though she's like, I'm ready for this thing to be out of me, it's too early. That baby needs to stay inside of you. Because that baby coming too early is going to deal with some health issues. That baby needs to stay in you. But at month 9, it's the appropriate season. And it's the appropriate season to start to see or expect this birth. And if you were to see this mom carrying this baby at month 9, and 2 weeks, you would say, that baby's holding on. There's some things you can do, ma'am, to speed that along, you know. Go drink some of that oil, go run, you know, do something to get that baby moving, you know. It's time. If you were to see her 4 weeks from then, and you were to say, wait a minute, you're at almost 11 months now. And I know the season that God's given for a baby to be born is 9 months, but you're 11, you would start to say, this isn't healthy now. This is scary. For you, for the baby, this is not good. If you were to see this lady 5 more months down the road and you were to say, it has been a year and a half, that is not a baby in you, I am sorry, it's not. You would say, she went too long. Way too long. Listen, your night season is something in the sovereignty of God. It happens in your life and those that you love that you'll have to watch and stand by. But there's an appropriate time and season. And when the season is over, you'll need to rise and walk out. Don't leave early. Don't stay late. Don't leave the garden early. Don't stay too late. Don't be ashamed that you're in a night season if you're going through one. Don't be ashamed that I feel exhausted. Don't be ashamed that I find myself praying the same thing in this season. Don't let your will hijack His will in the season. And yet if the season is over, whenever that time comes that it's concluded, trust Him to stand up and walk out. Because on the backside of the night season is when He starts to break you and send you away and send you. And what you went through in the night season becomes the testimony that He uses to liberate this family or liberate this gentleman or liberate this lady or set this person at freedom to know that God will carry him. God will touch you. God will use you. This morning, as we conclude, I want to pray for you because, once again, we deal with night season from a lot of different angles. Some of you are in it. Some of you are headed to it. Some of you are coming out of it. Some of you, this whole entire time that I've talked, you could not get your son out of your mind or you couldn't get this friend out of your mind. And we want to take a moment to pray. So all across the room, would you bow with me for a word of prayer? And just say, Jesus, this morning we come to you. And each of us carry the night season differently. We approach the night season a little differently. And we're affected by it differently. For some of us, we're like Jesus, the hour has come. For some of us, we've been in it for a while. We've been in the garden for a long time. And Father, I pray that all across this room, Lord, that you would minister to your people. There are those in here that need a refreshing. Just as the angel strengthened Jesus, that they need a strengthening this week. And I pray, Father, that you would strengthen them with your presence. You would dispatch angels that would fight on their behalf, that they would minister to them, that they would strengthen them as well. I pray, Father, if there's somebody that's coming to mind, God, that you would give words of encouragement, that you'd give words not of heaviness, but words of help to those that are going to be reaching out to a loved one that's going through a night season. Jesus, I thank you, Father, that even in the night season you meet us, even in the night season you carry us, even in the night season you're faithful and true. And so this morning, Jesus, all across this room, we yield our life to you. We yield our hearts to you. We yield the scenarios to you that we are not in control of. And we ask you to be lifted up and we ask you to be lifted high and that your purposes and your plans would be accomplished in our life. Jesus, I pray that not just this day, but this week would be a day, a week of your impact and your presence. Set your family at liberty. Infuse your family, Father, with strength. Infuse your family, Father, with your presence this week. And I pray, Jesus, that your name ultimately be lifted high. Jesus, we love you so much this morning. We give you all the honor and all the praise in Jesus' mighty name. And everybody said, amen.